Morning.
Morning.
We'll let Doug have a seat. So we have, for those who are watching us online, we have fewer and fewer people here today, so we'll be monitoring that. Several things. Thing number one is that, that's Sesame Street, or a, Dr. Seuss thing. Okay, thing number one. Dick Brown has come up with a good idea. And so I'm going to say this online, so he's going to text me to remind me, but someone else will remind me, including my wife, who is here today, to remind me that we're going to purchase some cards, some Christmas cards, which will be available next week. And each of the cards will represent a member of our church who is in the nursing home. And what we're going to do is we're going to have anyone who is here, we're going to give them to Kim, who always has too much things to do. So maybe we'll put them outside in the Arnold Hall on a table with some pens and some hand sanitizer and whatever. And then when you enter the church, you can sign your name and put a greeting. Because as you know, the most vulnerable members of our population are members in the nursing home, but they're also the most isolated. And in some ways, many of them are the most depressed, and because of the fact that they are unable to get out and see people, and people are not able to come in and see them as well, so it makes things difficult. So I think Dick Brown came up with a really great idea, and so let's put that into action. Second of all, Kim Seekinen has identified a family that's in need during this time. And the deacons have provided her with some Topps gift cards to give to them so that they can actually have food for this holiday season. I've asked Kim if she could identify the sizes of the children and other things like that so that we could perhaps collect some gifts for them so that they have some holiday. They are connected to the church, but I'm not going to say any of their names. They're not members of the church. They're just connected to the church. So we will work on that. So if anyone is interested in helping out with that, we talk to me, and I'll work with Kim to make sure that this family has a special Christmas. We are continuing to collect peanut butter and jelly until the 10th. So we'll actually probably still collect it next Sunday as well. Coats for the cold, we're still collecting, and we've received some really great coats, so thank you for that. We are still collecting, of course, the Giving Tree donations, so we appreciate all those who have helped with that as well. So anything that we can do throughout this Christmas season to help people is what we're trying to do. This is, of course, a particularly difficult Christmas season for many, and so we want to be able to be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ by serving those in need. We are, as of today, you know, people, you know, there's this belief that if you say knock on wood, that's superstitious, but you know, actually, knock on wood came from the church. It was the old communion tables were made out of wood, and people would say knock on wood, meaning knock on the communion table. So knock on wood. If we all have, if everything goes well and we continue to have worship, live worship, we will be having worship service on Christmas Eve at 7 p.m. We will be taking reservations for that like we did in the old days when we first started opening the church, because we want to make sure that we have enough space for everyone. So we'll be coordinating that in the next week or so. So that you can sign up. If you are, if you're anxious and you want to make sure, please contact me. If you have my cell phone, you can text me, or you can call the church. My extension at the church is 104. So if you're calling the church, you can just dial extension 104, and that gets you directly to me and or my voicemail. Sometimes people will call and they'll be leaving a message on the general line, and sometimes it takes a few weeks for me to get it. So the best way just is to call me directly. I don't know if we're confirmation class is continuing. Where is she? It's going remote. Okay, so this Lockport schools, as you know, are going remote. So now confirmation class is going to go to remote. Sunday school is already remote. Everything is remote except for me, I guess. Sometimes people wish they had a remote control so they could fast forward me a little bit, but we'll continue to go as we are. Okay, well, let us begin our worship today with opening prayers. A voice cries out in the wilderness. Let us line the road with beauty. For the Holy One is coming our way. I just heard myself in the background. Okay. A voice cries out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. A choir sings in the silence, come Emmanuel. Every valley shall be filled, every heart shall be made whole, for peace is stronger than turmoil, and love is louder than hate. As we light our second Advent candle, come now, O child of Mary. As the bell choir comes up, we have been handing out again the ribbons for this week. And so if you haven't received your ribbon yet, please do so before the end of the worship service. Okay, there we are. We're going to be working together, Hatton and I. He's going to turn me off sometimes when I sing. So, I'm so used to you. Every time I stand up, I want to put my mask on. You know, have you ever noticed that? So that's why sometimes I keep on fumbling with my mask. So if I'm wearing my mask when I'm standing up inadvertently, that's just because it's second nature now, it seems. Jesus Christ reminds us that we are but earthen vessels. Sometimes our earthen vessels are cracked. They're cracked to let the light shine through. Let us prepare to confess our sins before you and before one another. Prepare the way of the Lord, your prophet says to us. Forgive us when we have failed to prepare your way. Forgive us when we have stood in your way instead. When we let the challenging words of your prophets roll off of lives, rather than let them spark change. When we walk around a neighbor in need, rather than encounter a chance for compassion. Forgive us, O Lord, and grant us assurance that the glory of your coming does not depend upon the righteousness of your followers. Forgive us, O Lord, and free us to try again. Amen. This statement is reliable and worthy of our acceptance. Christ Jesus entered the world to rescue sinners. He personally bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. You may be seated. As Maria comes up to sing, I would like to note that those of you who get the newsletter, the email newsletter, I put Maria's full biography in the newsletter, and she's, as you know, quite impressive. And in her biography, it does mention First Presbyterian Church, which I thought was very nice. It has all these accolades, and then it mentions that, and she's in the choir of First Presbyterian Church. So it just it's nice to know that we made the biography. But it's very impressive. We are just so fortunate to have Maria as part of our church, and I think that she doesn't necessarily always get the credit that she deserves. And so I just would like to lift up her today as she sings.
Hello, my name is Lucian, and today I'll be reading Psalms 85, 1 through 2, and 8 through 13. You, Lord, showed favor to your land. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people and covered their sins. I will listen what God the Lord says. He promises peace to his people, his faithful servants. But let them not turn to folly. Surely his salvation near those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Love and faithfulness meet together, righteousness and peace kiss each other. Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from the heaven. The Lord will indeed give what is good, and our land will yield its harvest. Righteousness goes before him and prepares the way for his steps.
I will be reading from, I didn't bring my King James version of the, so let me, but I think it just sounds good in the King James version, so I'm going to do that. Comfort ye, my people, saith your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem and cry unto her, that her warfare is accomplished, that her iniquity is pardoned. For she hath received of the Lord's hand double for all of her sins. A voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. And every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. The voice said, cry, and he said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all the goodliness thereof is as the flower of the field. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of God, our God, shall stand forever. O Zion, that brightest good tidings, get thee up into the high mountain, O Jerusalem, that bringeth good tidings, lift up the voice with strength, lift it up, be not afraid, say unto the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God will come with strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. He shall feed his flock like a shepherd. He shall gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom and shall gently lead those that are with young. This ends the reading of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So, several things that come to mind when I read this passage. The first thing that comes to mind, of course, is that in our book of worship, which has been revised now twice since I've been the pastor, I've been a pastor, which shows that you've been a pastor a long time when they've revised something twice. In that book of worship for memorial services, it gives suggested readings. And of course, the most common suggested reading in these memorial service come from Psalm 23, Psalm 146, Psalm 121, John chapter 14, in my Father's house there are many mansions, and this one, comfort ye, saith my people. This particular book, chapter in Isaiah also has, and he shall lift them up as on eagle's wings. This is a passage that brings comfort to those who are in need. It was written to a people in Israel that had struggled mightily, and their latest struggle came when they were held in captivity by the Babylonians. They were taken from their land, and they imagined what life would be like in a return to their homeland. Sing us a song of Zion, but we hung up our harps, comes from this period. What shall we do, said the people of Israel. And from that came the voice of God through Isaiah, comfort ye, saith the Lord. The first time I read this passage was at a memorial service for a woman who had been a member of my church. She lived in this big house in the countryside, not that far from Canandaigua, where I was the pastor, or Geneva, where I was the pastor at the time. And I would go and visit her there all the time. Her house was wonderful, and her company was wonderful. She came to church on a regular basis, and we got along, other than the fact that at the time I was a Boston Red Sox fan and she was a diehard Yankees fan. The year that she passed away was the first year in many years that the Yankees went to the World Series and won. She never got to see that. She passed away before they won the World Series. Her calling hours were in her house, sort of old-fashioned. In the old days, that's when all the calling hours were, in her living room. I remember that she kept meticulous notes, and she said, if Pastor Hardy does my memorial service, make sure that it's not too short. No one has ever said that about me, but it was in her notes. I read these words, comfort ye, my people. And as I read these words, I remember reading something that I thought was powerful. And Isaiah evidently thought it was powerful too, because he repeats it twice. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass. And he says it again, the grass withereth, the flower fadeth. But then he says something similar to what we talked about last week. But the word of God shall stand forever. The word of God will stand forever. Last week we said that the word of Jesus will stand forever, forever. This week we say the word of God shall stand forever. At this memorial service, I preached about the word of God. Today I preach about the word of God. For generations, people have preached about the word of God. When I was first the pastor here, I was given a sermon. The sermon was written by the man whose stained glass window was dedicated, Reverend William Wisner. He served this church for decades, I think the longest serving pastor of this church. In fact, he passed away while still the pastor of this church, or close after he retired. He was the pastor during the Civil War. And in that sermon, he preached about the end of the Civil War. Imagine that. Imagine. I just want you to think for a moment that at one time there was a pastor. Not at this pulpit, because the pulpit was right in the center. At one time, there was a pastor that stood up from a pulpit in this very church, in this very room, in this very sanctuary, and preached about the end of the Civil War. The pews that you sit in are original. People who were listening to that sermon were sitting in the very pews that you sit in. And he talked about the word of God, and he preached about the end of a war that had brutally taken so many American citizens, brothers fighting against brothers, cousins fighting against cousins, the horror. And he preached from this very place to a congregation, comforting them, those who had lost so much and had seen so much loss. The word of God was still powerful then as it is today. Granted, at that time, so many people came to this church that they needed the balconies to fill them all. And in that particular day, every single pew was filled. And he preached without a microphone. His sermon sometimes lasted several hours, and he preached twice on a Sunday, in the morning, and then he would go home, and then he would come back and preach in the evening. The word of God, present then as it is today. The grass will wither, the flower will fade. I love flowers myself. Gardening is one of my favorite things to do. I planted an amaryllis bulb this year. And Jenna was watching it grow, and she said, you know, we should have taken pictures of every day of its growth. One day I saw that it was tilting, so I moved it. And it fell right out of the pot onto the ground, dirt all over the place. I wanted to cry over a flower. I took it home and I put it in a new pot. And Justin helped me by tying it up to a pole to keep it straight. And now the flowers start to fade. They start to turn brown. But one of the flowers fell off, and Renee put it in a glass of water, and that one still stays white and looks like it is as fresh as the day it fell off the stem. But it will eventually fade. It will be a memory. But the word of the Lord will stand. The memory will stand of that beautiful flower. The memory of these times will fade, will pass. But they will be a reminder that what has made us whole in difficult times, what has helped us get through this, is the promise of God and his conviction that there is no hardship, no pain, no sighing, no sorrow that we cannot overcome. God has made us into a formidable presence in the world. God, when God created us, said, "You shall be created in my image." It's taken me a while to imagine what that means. Does it mean that God looks like Santa Claus sitting in a cloud? Does it mean that God looks like me with all my zits and with my shave cuts that bled onto my mask? Or does it mean that God is this powerful presence in our lives that transcends who we are and what we look like? God is a powerful presence in our hearts, in our souls, in our very being. God is a powerful source of strength. God stands up in our hearts and does not allow us to be defeated. But some of us, we do feel defeated, don't we? Some of us have seen death and we wonder why. Some of us, even in this church today, at this very moment, feel anxiety and stress as they need to be away from loved ones who are dying at this very moment and wondering why I can't see them one last time. People are watching on Zoom as saying goodbye to their loved ones for the very last time. And we wonder, does God's word stand through this? This reminds us again how powerful prayer is and how important we are, those of us who have faith. I was reading long ago of a Harvard study, about prayer. And they were wondering, the question was, does prayer work? And of course, I've read a lot of studies, and some of the studies say prayer doesn't work. And some says prayer actually makes people who are sick get sicker because they get anxious knowing that everyone else is praying for them and they have performance anxiety. But this particular study said that prayer works. They said that people who know that they're being prayed for and people that are prayed for tend to get better. They have had studies that people who attend church are healthier, more hopeful, more positive. They've done studies that suggest that people who are in nursing homes that receive prayers from members of their church tend to be happier, tend to be more resilient in times of suffering. What gives me comfort is knowing that God's word stands, to know that for generations past, pastors have stood up here and preached about the Word of God. Some of them have preached about it in times of incredible anxiety and stress. Some of them have preached before the coffins of young children or in front of the coffins of people who have come back and died in war, young people, people with their whole lives ahead of them. And yet they preach the word, comfort me, ye, saith the Lord. Speak ye tenderly unto Israel. Every valley and mountain shall be made low, the crooked places a plain. These words are not just words to me. They're not dead letters on a page. They're not just notations on a piece of paper. To me, they live. They're alive. To me, they are like the scent of incense flowing into the heavens. To me, they matter because they are real, because they are God's words. To me, they bring hope and comfort and strength because they are alive and they live in us. For we are in God's image because we carry God's word in our hearts. And because we carry God's words in our hearts, though death defeats us, life remains abundant. Life remains eternal. Life carries on in the midst of hardship. Advent is about this hope, about this idea of grace and love and power. We have been given it. And we are not to put it under a bushel. In these moments when the darkness comes each day more dark than the rest, than the last, be reminded that we carry that light in our hearts. We are created in God's image. And because of it, let the word of God flow from us into the world, into others' lives, into this broken nation, reminding us that God is alive, alive indeed. Amen. We talk about prayer. The week before, I got on the telephone with Dorothy Degnan, and I said a prayer over the phone with her. And it mattered to her, even though we were over the phone and not, I wasn't able to hold her hand or be present with her. Dick Brown said that that was one of the things that she talked about the most. The pastor prayed for me. Sometimes maybe we can just call someone on the phone or send a card and say, you are not alone. Right now, a member of our church is struggling. Steve Lecters would like to lift up his brother-in-law, Doug, who is in the ICU in a coma and on a ventilator with COVID and other underlying conditions. Take a moment to pause and think about that. He is alone. His family is unable to be with him. But when we pray for him, my prayer is that our prayer will descend upon him like the Holy Spirit. For a moment, he will know that he is not alone. Right now, as we pray here in this church and as others pray for him, He may not survive, but let him know in his heart that he is not forgotten, that he is not alone. Maybe the greatest gift that we can give to another is a reminder that God's word stands. Let us pray. Dearest Lord, we are again faced with struggles. A family in need whose Christmas will be challenged by lack of money. But we are the church. And because we are the church, we will gather our resources to help that family, to remind them that they are loved, because we are God's children, and they are God's children. Because of that, we will love. Out there in the ICU, in a hospital, surrounded by a ventilator and tubes and IVs, is a man by the name of Doug. He has a wife and a family who are unable to be with him. He's in a coma, surrounded by strangers. But we love his brother-in-law, Steve. We know him to be a selfless and wonderful man. And we lift up Steve and his brother-in-law today, knowing that this is a hard day. This is a painful day, but Steve's in the right place today. We know that, dear Lord. He's in the church, surrounded by people who care about him, surrounded by angels in windows reminding us that I shall raise you up as on eagle's wings. We comfort those who are feeling sorrow on this day. We ask that you would lift them up with blessings and hope. Dearest Lord, be with those with silent prayers, prayers of confusion, of anger, with parents who are again in Lockport are facing the idea and the struggle of homeschooling and virtual classes, who are wondering who will watch my children while I go to work, what will I do, how can I face this struggle. We'd ask that you would lift them up with hope, remind them that they have friends and neighbors who care for them, who love them. Be with our children who again are struggling, not knowing what is going on in their future, hoping against hope that this will end soon. Be with our doctors. Be with the FDA, who next week will make a decision over the vaccine, whether to move it forward. Bless them as they continue their work. Bless nurses and doctors, firefighters and police officers, members of the armed service, many of whom are being lifted up and called to do things that they have never done before. Bless them and keep them. Be with our friends in Erie County. Be with our pastors in churches in Erie County that must now be totally remote. Bless the churches there as they go through challenging times like they faced in the spring. Remind them that they are not alone, that we love them and pray for them. Lift us all up, those who are anxious, those who are afraid. Comfort, comfort ye my people, saith the Lord. Speak ye tenderly for Jerusalem. The pain, the sorrow, the iniquity has ended. Let us be blessed in the knowledge that hope lies not only in the future, but lies here among us today in Christ Jesus, who will soon be born in a manger, not far away in a distant land, but a manger in our hearts. He will rise up in us, and he will be our Savior. We'd ask this in the name of your Savior, our Savior, Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So last week I was showing one of my friends the video of our worship service, and I said, here's the part where I tell a joke. And they said, he looked at it, and this is his response. He said, boy, I really love your organ. It's so beautiful. I'm like, what about my joke? So anyway, go figure. I guess my joke wasn't nearly as funny as I thought, but the organ is wonderful. And we all agree with that. Sometimes we take that for granted, and you hear the organ over the internet, and you see this beautiful sanctuary. I mean, look, those of you who are here, I would recommend that you go to our Facebook page afterwards and just watch the service. Now with the new cameras, you can see how it's just, you miss it sometimes. I've been looking, I have it on to see if anyone puts in a prayer request, and you can see all these, it's just gorgeous. It's just a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful place to be. And we are so fortunate. And Jeff has made it even more glamorous. If you look up at the lights, it just that's to remind us of Christmas. During this next week, what I want you to think about, and maybe this will give you hope, Imagine for a moment you are a child, and it's Christmas Eve, and you're in your bed after your Christmas Eve service, and you're laying in bed, and you're thinking, Santa Claus is coming. And you're thinking, and Santa's going to bring me something, a gift of something or something. And you're excited, and the adrenaline is flowing. And you have this miraculous feeling that everything is going to be okay. The excitement, the joy, all of those emotions in your heart. I want you to try to tap into that. Think about all the things that you feel in your hearts over the years that have made you hopeful, that have taken away the anxiety. Think about those things and know that those things were not bogus. They weren't wrong. They were what you were tapping into that was genuine, that was real, that was true. The powerful image and wonder of God's love at that moment transcends everything else and makes us whole. Let us be positive. Let our positivity reign within us in such a way that it will be infectious, that others will catch our positivity and know that we are hopeful. Because I truly believe that when hope prevails in our lives, it will transcend all the frustrations and all the horror around us and make us whole and heal us. Go forth in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, knowing that you are loved. Amen.